As you probably know, internal combustion engines are not very efficient. On average, modern gasoline engines in passenger cars can do a thermal efficiency of around 35%. Diesel versions can do a bit above 40%, but they need complicated and expensive emissions control equipment to be as clean as their gasoline counterparts. An efficiency of 35% means that of the energy content of the fuel, only 35% gets converted into useful work. 65% is lost. Some of it is lost to the internal friction inside the engine, but most of it escapes out the exhaust as heat and noise.
So why is so much energy wasted? Why can't we efficiently harness more of it? Well, as you probably know, a four-stroke engine has four strokes. Intake, compression, combustion, and exhaust. Each of these is 180 degrees of crankshaft rotation, and so the full combustion cycle is 720 degrees. The problem we have is that all of the strokes are of equal length and duration, but it is only the combustion stroke which is actually producing a significant amount of energy. All the other strokes are more or less wasting energy. So if we could give the engine more time and space to actually harness the energy of combustion to somehow have a longer combustion stroke, then the engine would be more efficient. The fact that the combustion stroke isn't long enough is made very obvious by the amount of energy left in the exhaust gas, which we can see and hear as heat and noise coming from the engine's exhaust. If we harnessed more energy from the exhaust, then there would be a lot less heat and noise left in the exhaust gas. It is, in fact, a common misconception that it is the upward motion of the piston that pushes the exhaust gas out of the cylinder during the exhaust stroke. This is not really true, because when the combustion stroke is over and the exhaust stroke begins, there is still so much energy left in the exhaust gas that its pressure is anywhere between 4 to 6 times higher than atmospheric pressure. So it's at around 4 to 6 bar, or somewhere between 58 to 87 psi. And that's because the engine did not have enough time, enough length, enough space to harness the energy during the combustion stroke or the expansion stroke, if you will. And so when the exhaust valve opens, the exhaust gases, because they're so highly pressurized, they're actually escaping out of the cylinder by themselves. Most vacate the cylinder easily by themselves before the piston does anything about it. That's how much energy is left in the exhaust gas. One of the ways to increase engine efficiency is to increase the compression ratio. Now, the compression ratio is simply the ratio between the smallest and the largest cylinder volume. The smallest volume occurs whenever the piston is at the top dead center, the very top of its stroke. The largest cylinder volume occurs when the piston is at bottom dead center. So if the smallest volume is 10 units of volume, cubic centimeters, whatever, doesn't matter, and the largest cylinder volume is 100 units of volume, then we have a compression ratio of 10 to 1. If we increase the compression ratio to 12 to 1 or 13 to 1, doesn't matter, what we're doing is that we are changing the ratio between these two spaces. We are changing the ratio between the space when combustion starts, we are making this space smaller, and we are making the space during which combustion energy is harnessed, the expansion of the engine, we are making this space larger. So by increasing the compression ratio, we are effectively giving the engine more time to harness the energy of combustion, which of course improves efficiency. Unfortunately, we are limited in how much we can increase the compression ratio. If we increase it too much, then we reduce the space where we are compressing the air-fuel mixture, we start squeezing it too much, and if we squeeze the air-fuel mixture too much, then it spontaneously self-ignites, leading to knock, and this destroys an engine. But even if we don't have potential issues with knock, like in diesel engines, there is still a limit to how much we can increase the compression ratio, because At some point, the space becomes very, very small where combustion occurs, and a lot of energy of the combustion is being transferred very violently and rapidly onto the piston because the piston is now very close to the combustion. So to avoid the engine falling apart, we have to make the piston and the connecting rod and the crankshaft more robust. And if we make them more robust, we make them heavier. This is exactly what happens in diesel engines. They have more robust internals, which are heavier, and so they can't rev as high. But there is another problem with compression ratios, and why we can't increase them too much is that if we increase them a lot, the combustion temperature becomes very, very high, and this leads to increased nitrogen oxide emissions. So we are limited with what we can do with the compression ratio, so we must look for other ways to increase efficiency. Of course, the ideal thing would be to somehow make the combustion, aka the expansion stroke, longer than all the other strokes. That way the engine would spend more time harnessing energy and less time wasting it. But as we know, the traditional engine anatomy does not permit unequal stroke lengths. And this is precisely why a man named James Atkinson decided to forego the traditional engine anatomy and created a brand new one, which did allow a significantly longer combustion stroke. Atkinson's engine was indeed more efficient, but his rotating assembly was kind of delicate and fragile, which made the engine a bit unreliable, but also very much unsuited to increased RPM operation. Even the inventor of the traditional four-stroke engine himself, Nicolaus Otto, wanted to increase the length of the combustion stroke. Even he saw the limits of his design and wanted to improve efficiency. But him, together with Gottlieb Daimler, decided to take on another approach. Instead of inventing a new and unproven rotating assembly, they decided to rely on existing proven engine anatomy. And what they did is that they simply added one more cylinder to harness the energy remaining in the exhaust gas. The engine known as the Verbundmotor had three cylinders. The outer two cylinders were high pressure cylinders, and the middle inner cylinder was a low pressure cylinder. The outer cylinders, the high-pressure cylinders, operate like normal four-stroke cylinders. They do intake, compression, combustion or expansion, and then exhaust. But instead of exhausting the gases into the atmosphere, the high-pressure cylinders send the exhaust gas into the low-pressure cylinder where the fifth stroke, now called extended expansion, occurs. The pressure remaining in the exhaust gas is used to drive the middle piston downward, so instead of wasting energy, we are using this energy to create torque. So instead of making the expansion stroke longer, like with the Atkinson, this design simply does expansion twice. This means that the engine effectively is given twice the time to harness every little bit of energy from the combustion, which of course improves efficiency. Well, all of that sounds great in theory, but in practice, Otto and Gottlieb's engine was a failure. It was commercialized and produced, but it suffered from poor performance, so production was discontinued. Probably because Otto and Gottlieb were working with technology from the late 1800s. And so the design was abandoned, but not forgotten. It lay dormant for 124 years until in 2003 it was awakened by Belgian engineer and inventor Gerhard Schmitz, who got a patent for a five-stroke engine design which was virtually identical to that of Otto and Gottlieb. Now, according to Wikipedia, Schmitz's design was actually preceded by two Spanish patents, one from 1942 and another from 1975. Be that as it may, Mr. Schmitz got his patent granted and proceeded to turn his vision into reality. Of course, getting a patent for a theoretical concept is one thing. Turning that concept into a running, working prototype is very much another. But here too, Mr. Schmitz managed to do something very impressive. He managed to convince a very serious company to turn his idea into reality. And that company is Ilmor Engineering. You may have not heard of them, but Ilmor Engineering is nothing like one of the newly sprung up names created around novel engine designs. Ilmor Engineering has been founded in 1983 by Mario Illien and Paul Morgan. And they're a very serious company because, among other things, they have been supplying engines for Chevrolet for IndyCar racing, engines for Sauber and Mercedes for racing in Formula One. They even competed in MotoGP, and in 2009, Ilmor's marinized version of the Dodge Viper V10 engine won the World Powerboat Championship. By the way, this engine, called the MV10725, produces 725 horsepower naturally aspirated, while meeting new strict emission standards which were put in place in 2009. In fact, in Europe, this engine was the highest rated commercially available emissions certified engine in existence. So when a company like this takes on the development of a novel engine design, it really gives the project credibility and high hopes of success. So Ilmor got busy with development, and just 4 years later, we got a fully working running prototype. Just like the patent, the prototype engine had three cylinders, two outer high pressure and one inner low pressure cylinder. It made 130 horsepower at 7,000 RPM and 166 Nm of torque at 5,000 RPM. All of this from just 700cc of displacement, with a fuel consumption of a very low 226 grams per kilowatt hour. And because Ilmor is a reputable company, we didn't get the kind of nonsense that we get from novel engine designs nowadays. You know, stuff like twice the balls, half the hair, whatever, half this, twice that. None of that. Ilmor were actually realistic with their numbers, and they said that the engine was 20% lighter and 10% more fuel efficient than any equivalent competitor engine. And indeed, the engine did have the power of a much larger gasoline engine, while having the fuel economy of an equivalent turbo diesel engine, but without the increased nitrogen oxide and particulate matter emissions. The beauty of this design lies in the fact that, number one, has a pretty much perfect engine balance, because the two outer pistons are equal in mass to the inner, a larger piston, so they balance each other out. And number two, the great thing is that it is based on 100% conventional technology, conventional rods, piston, crankshaft, camshaft, and other hardware. So there's no need to invest massive amounts of research and development into a completely novel rotating assembly or any other hardware. The engine got an official presentation at the 2009 Stuttgart Engine Expo, after which it got a fair bit of media attention, and then after that, nothing. Zero, zilch, nada. After a period of complete silence and total lack of development, it was later found out that Gerhard Schmidt left Ilmor Engineering, took the patent rights with him, and went on to develop a allegedly improved version of the five-stroke engine with a team of French engineers. They developed a slightly modified version, which also offered promising test results, just like the Ilmor engine. But also, just like the Ilmor engine, this version of the five-stroke also never made it passed the prototype stage, and it quickly faded into obscurity, never to be heard from again. So when we look at the five-stroke engine, it is obvious that this is a efficient design, a simple and elegant solution to a existing problem, and it also relies on existing technology, conventional technology. So upon first glance, it is pretty hard to fault this engine. So we must ask, why did it fail? Well, there are three reasons. Reason number one, which is the least important reason, but it must be mentioned, is that Ilmor was not entirely honest with their numbers. The engine, their prototype, was classified as a 700cc engine. And that's because only the displacement of the outer two high-pressure cylinders is counted. The displacement of the inner cylinder is not counted, because combustion never occurs in that cylinder, so it's not classified as a working cylinder, and therefore the engine is classified as having 700cc. If we count the inner cylinder as well, the engine is very close to 1.5 liters, so although it is classified as 700cc, it is still a physically, well, in terms of size and how much space it occupies, it is physically a 1.5 liter engine. And also, the engine had a very small turbocharger on it to harness the last little bit of exhaust gas energy and further improve the power output of the engine. So although the claim that it is lighter and more efficient than competitor engines was true, the engine was also more complex and more expensive than these competitor engines. And also, I believe that the engine was only 20% lighter than competitors because Ilmor used some very high-end manufacturing techniques like billet engine blocks that probably would never make it into mass production. But this is only a minor issue. Over time, the design could be further developed and likely simplified, and the costs would be reduced over time. The big problem is issue number two, which is that the energy left in the exhaust gas, the heat and the pressure left in the exhaust gas, fluctuates with engine load and engine RPM. At high load and high RPM, we have a lot of energy left in the exhaust gas because we have very high and powerful, strong combustions at these operating conditions. But at low load and low RPM, we have small, weak combustions, which means that there's pretty much no energy left in the exhaust gas. There's very little energy there, which means that the middle piston, which is supposed to harness this energy, becomes a dead weight. It can't harness anything because there's not much to harness. It actually takes more energy to move it up and down than there's left in the exhaust gas, which means that in these scenarios, low load, low RPM, the middle piston is actually sucking energy from the two outer high-pressure pistons and reducing the efficiency of the engine. And as we know, in the real world, real driving conditions, low load and low RPM operation can be just as, if not more important than high RPM, high load operation. The final nail in the coffin of the five-stroke is that harnessing more energy from the exhaust gas means that there is less heat and pressure and noise left in the exhaust gas. That's great for muffler design, but it's very bad for turbochargers and, more importantly, catalytic converters. A five-stroke can run only a very, very small turbocharger, and it takes longer for it to get a catalytic converter up to temperature, which means that a five-stroke engine would likely fail modern emission standards. And so this design to the five-stroke engine ultimately joined a very long list of engines and designs that claimed to be disruptive technology, but ultimately failed to even make a tiny dent in the conventional four-stroke design. In 3 years, the conventional four-stroke engine will be 150 years old. That's 1.5 centuries. There is no other device of comparable mechanical complexity that has been so omnipresent on planet Earth since the late 1800s. It has resisted hundreds upon hundreds of attempts at usurpation, and nothing ever managed to phase it. The Wankel engine sort of got up to say something, but it was gone before it could finish the sentence. The conventional design stayed, and it just kept evolving and evolving, getting better and better, and ultimately proving that it can do everything that the revolutionary engines claimed, and can do it better and cheaper. I really wish we could revive Nikolaus Otto for like a few hours just to see his reaction to how far we have taken this thing and how omnipresent it still is. He would probably try to charge everybody for patent rights or sue companies or something, but I would still love to see it. And I'm sure somebody's gonna type in the comments how ICE is over, how the era of the conventional four-stroke is over, and how electric vehicles are the future, and yeah, sure, maybe, whatever, who knows, I'm having a moment here, read the room, and let me know when any kind of propulsion technology manages to last 150 years. Thank you very much. Yeah, okay, I'm gonna stop here. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.